Welcome to this instructional video. It's Dr. Adam here, and today's instructional video is going to be on the last steps to take with your colony to get them ready to go into winter. So let's go along and see how we set our hives up for success as they go into the winter. So we're here in our bee yard. It's the end of the season, and we're getting ready to shut these hives down completely. So this is the last steps that you're going to take after all your mite management, after treatments have been put in, after you've consolidated your colony down. These are the last steps you take to get the colony through the winter. So we're here at a 10 frame hive. You can see this is how I'm going to overwinter this hive. I've got one deep and three mediums on here. And really, depending on where you are in the United States, this wintering process I'm going to show you will work for pretty much everybody. The difference is how much honey you're going to leave on over the winter. And that varies greatly depending on where you're at. So for someone like myself, who's up here in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, this is going to be equivalent to about 150 or more pounds of honey that's on this colony as you see it right now. So that's how I like to get our colonies into the winter. This colony right here is completely backfilled. I can even come up to this thing and try and pick this darn thing up from the front, and there's no budge in this. This is a very heavy colony. And so everything's been consolidated down, meaning that there are no gaps in resources throughout this entire colony. Every box you see here is completely backfilled with honey. And so we spent the entire month of September feeding these colonies to make sure every bit of space in these colonies is backfilled with nectar. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to set this up for winter. So the first thing I want to caution you of before we get started is queen excluders. I do not run queen excluders on any of my colonies. It's a personal preference if you want to run them or not. But if you are running queen excluders, these must come off at this time in the season. Keep in mind that your cluster is going to be moving up over the course of winter, feeding on honey reserves and thermoregulating in a cluster. If you have a queen excluder on, your cluster will move and your queen will be sequestered below the screen. So this has to come out. That is the very first thing you should be thinking about, is making sure if you're running one of these that they are not in the colony at this point in time. So we get rid of our queen excluder. Now, the equipment that you're going to need to do this is pretty simple, and I'm going to show you real quick what we use. The first thing you're going to need is an entrance reducer, and we'll install that as one piece of equipment on this colony as we shut it down. The next thing you're going to need is a spacer. Now, this is a 1x3 spacer made out of 1x3 lumber, and really what it offers you is a top entrance in the form of the hole that you see up front here, which is about a half inch hole on the front of this colony. It offers you space to allow to feed supplemental during the winter. So if your colony happens to run through its food over the course of the winter, you have an opportunity to supplementally feed up here on top with the mountain camp method, or you could use a candy board if you wanted to, but I prefer the mountain camp method, which is just a sheet of newspaper and then filling this with dry sugar if your colony gets through the is moving through the winter and runs out of resources. So it offers you that as well. You can see on this particular one, now I make these, you can see on this particular one, I have number 4 hardware cloth in the bottom of it as well. There's a reason for that. Number one, the number 4 hardware cloth will allow the bees to move through it, so they won't be stuck below it. But you will invariably, particularly on some colonies that you may think might be running out of food, but they actually had quite enough to get through the winter, you'll end up with extra sugar up here on top if they don't touch it or they don't use all of it. Now, if you just lay your newspaper right on down on top of the frames and not on a piece of hardware cloth, it's not a big deal. But when you go back at the end of the season and you're cleaning things up, this is much easier to remove because you can remove the sugar and everything at one time. If it's right on top of the frames, you're going to have to kind of shove that sugar off. It's going to get down into the frames. This is just a little easier way to move it out at the end of the season. So that's why I have these on our spacers. The other thing that you're going to need is a moisture board of some sort. Moisture boards, you can purchase these from any of your major beekeeping supply companies. I would prefer, if you're going to purchase them, make sure you're purchasing about 2 for every colony, because these will get saturated over time, and you will want to be able to replace them out if you need to over the course of the winter. You can also make these, and the material that you make them out of is called homosote. It's a sound deadening material that you can buy from Menards or Lowe's or Home Depot. They come in 4x8 sheets, and you can cut those down. I use both of them. They both work exactly the same, but you need to have a moisture board of some sort. A 2-inch piece of pink foam insulation is the next thing that you're going to need. Now, you can buy this from any hardware store, building supply company. You don't need a saw to break these apart and to get them to the right size. You just score them and snap them, so they're very easy to work with. But you're going to need one of these for every single one of your colonies. And then the last piece of all of this is our 15-pound roofing paper, so black tar paper. Now, we use this around the colony, and we don't use it to cut down any wind or help with winter at all. That's not really what this is for. What this is for is when we hit the springtime and we start to break out of winter, the colony is going to start putting on brood. And when it starts putting on brood, you get in situations where we get warmer days, say kind of in the 50-degree temperatures, they're on and huddled around the brood. If we have black tar paper on the colony itself, it allows that heat to absorb into the body of the hive itself and allows that cluster to expand a little bit. And what that allows those bees to do when there's brood on, because when there's brood on, they will not leave the brood, and they can actually starve in place with brood on, even if there's food all around them. And so what we do with this tar paper is we allow that heat to accumulate in the colony. It allows that cluster to loosen up a little bit, and they can reach some food resources that they couldn't access before while still staying on the brood. The other thing that it does is when we hit those 50-degree days during the day here in the Upper Peninsula, we may hit, it may plummet when we hit night, and we may be into single digits. And so it also allows for a little bit of that heat absorption to stay with the colony so the colony can cluster back a little slower. So it's just aids in that spring kind of brood rearing process. So this really doesn't come into play until we hit spring, but it is an important component of how we're going to set up our hives. So let's go through the step-by-step instruction of how we're going to do this on this colony right here as we're getting it ready for winter. All right, so let's take a look at this colony. What are the first things you're going to do as you shut down your colony at the end of the year? Well, the first thing we're going to do is putting in an entrance reducer. Now, depending on the strength of your colony, this may have already been in a little earlier in the season, maybe on the medium opening right here. And that's usually to prevent robbing at the end of the season, as you close down a bunch of the front entrance there, and it's less area to defend for your bees. Now, in my situation here, this is a very strong colony. We didn't need to shut down the front of the entrance for any reason whatsoever, because it's strong enough to defend itself against any robbers. And so, as we're here at the end of the season, now it's time to put this on the smallest entrance that there is. And you can see that it's a very small entrance compared to the normal entrance. And this is our winter entrance. The only reason we really need this entrance, I mean, we have a top entrance that we're going to be putting on as well, but the real reason for this is obviously bees coming in and out. But over the course of winter, this will oftentimes get plugged by dead bees that, as your winter bees are dying over the course of the season, this may get kind of plugged up. But this also allows for passive airflow to come through the colony. So as your colony is sitting there, air is passively moving through there, through this bottom opening, and then kind of going through like a chimney effect through the top opening. So we're going to close this down first. So let's go ahead and put this on. Move our ladies out of the way. I just give them a gentle kind of nudge there, and they're all out of the way. So our entrance is shut down now. Next step of this is we're going to open the top here, and we're going to install our shim on the top. Now again, this is a very full colony, very heavy, lots of honey reserves, and so we've got a lot of bees in here as well. Now it's a pretty warm day today, so they're not clustered up. We're going to put our top entrance and our spacer on top here. Again, this will allow us to feed our colony if they start to run out of food over the winter. As you're doing your winter checks, you're going to be coming out. Especially if you're up where I am in the Upper Peninsula, you're going to be coming out usually starting in January or February. I'll come out, I'll pop the top of the colony, and if you see bees at the very top of this box, it means that your cluster has gone through its food resources and now is at the top and at risk of starvation. And that's when you would add that supplemental feed. You'd lay down a piece of newspaper right inside of here and then just fill it with dry granulated sugar. So that's our spacer. The next thing is the moisture board. Now, this is a moisture wicking device. As bees feed on honey over the course of winter, they respire in the form of hot, moist air. If you do nothing to manage moisture or temperature in this colony, what will happen is that moisture will accumulate on the inside of the inner cover and then rain back down on your cluster and freeze them out. And what this looks like, and I get this call all the time, is you have a perfectly looking, healthy looking cluster with lots of resources around it that is literally frozen in place dead. And that was all because of moisture not being managed. So we put a moisture board on top to help mitigate some of that moisture. And what this will do is it absorbs the moisture. If you come out during winter checks and see that this is frozen, you just put a new one in, take this one out, go set it by the fire or by the furnace in your house, let it dry out, and it's ready to use again. So they can be reused over and over again. I've had many of these for more than 5 years, so they work very well. Good investment. But this is what's going to go on next. And so if you do get moisture accumulating at the top, it's getting absorbed by this piece of material right here. Now, the next thing that we do is we add a 2-inch piece of pink insulation. And this is super important. I mean, all of this is very important. That's going to go right on top of your moisture board. Now, what this is doing is, like I had mentioned earlier, your bees are respiring over the course of winter while they're feeding on honey. That hot, moist air has to go somewhere. And hot, moist air condenses on cold surfaces, just kind of like your pop can and the moisture that condenses around that on a hot day. Now, what we've got here is a similar situation. The bees are putting off hot, moist air, and that's going to condense somewhere in the hive. Now, there's been a lot of research that's been done on the thermodynamics of bees. And really what we know is that about 75% of your heat that comes off of your bees is lost through the top cover. In addition, if you do nothing to alter the temperature of the top cover with insulation, what ends up happening is the top cover becomes the coldest surface in the colony, and oftentimes that's where all of that condensation will accumulate. What we do by putting on this piece of insulation is we are now mitigating some of the heat loss that's coming out of the top of the colony, and we're also changing the temperature of the top cover. So now we're not losing so much heat there. So heat is kind of residing up here in the top. And so your sidewalls become the coldest surface in the colony, which means that all that hot, moist air is going to condense on the sidewalls of the colony and run straight down, never interacting with your cluster, which is exactly what you want. So we have this 2-inch piece of insulation for that specifically, to change where that condensation starts to accumulate in the colony. The last thing we're going to do before we put our top cover and our inner cover on is we're going to wrap this colony. So I've got my tar paper here, and literally we're going to wrap this like a present. All right, so I'm going to give you a little bit of a different view on this as we wrap this up so that you're a little bit closer. All right, so we're going to get here on the side. I'm going to stick this up here. Put in a couple staples, and we're going to just come around. Wrap this. Now, it's definitely easier to pre-cut your felt paper, your tar paper. If you decide that you want to try and manhandle that roll around each one of these colonies, good on you. But I prefer to pre-cut them. And generally what I do is I just lay out the tar paper on the ground. I'll use a hive body that I have sitting around, and I'll use that as a template to measure all of these out before I get to this stage. Doesn't look like our stapler wants to cooperate just yet. There we go. All right. Now, you take out your pocket knife, and you're going to cut the edges of each edge down to the foam board. I'm just going to come here. I'm just going to cut down to the side. All right, and now we just fold it up like a present. We're sending it in to winter. Get my bottom or my top cover there ready, and I'm just gonna fold this in. I like to go front and back, and then side to side. It's just a personal preference, just doesn't really matter. You're gonna fold this in. Now, when you fold this in nice and neat like this, it makes it very easy to come to this in the winter and be able to open this up and check on it. So, all right, we're gonna put our inner cover on top of this. And it can go on top or it can go inside. It does not matter. And then our outer cover. All right. So the last piece of this is that we've got to come back to the front of our colony because we had a top entrance on there and we need that to be available for our bees. So let's go ahead. We're going to cut a spot in this top. Just notch out an area here. And there's our top entrance right there. We'll just cut that off. And there you go. The last step of this for me in my operation is a ratchet strap. And this ratchet strap will keep everything real nice and tight all winter long. So we'll attach this. And there you go. This is exactly how we overwinter colonies here at my farm, Beewise Farms. And what we have in the way of success for overwintering is generally we lose less than 10% of our colonies annually using this exact method. Now, this is one piece of the puzzle, right? The other piece of this is getting to this point. So this is just the last final preparation you're doing as you're going into winter. Now, you may at this point in time still have an oxalic acid treatment that you plan on doing later on in the season. And you would pull that front entrance out, plug the top, use your vaporizer if you're going to do that, or if you're going to use the dribble method, you're going to have to break this down, and I'd suggest not wrapping. If you're going to plan on doing dribble late season, don't wrap until you get the dribble done, because this is just going to be extra work. But if you're using the vaporization method, you can go ahead and wrap this up and get this buttoned up for winter before you do that. But leading into this, remember, mite management, big, big concern, and getting to this point, making sure you got enough resources on a colony. We did feed most of September on this colony just to make sure that that brood chamber was nice and backfilled. And like I showed you, I can't even lift this thing up off of the hive stand, which is a great indication that there is a lot of food for winter. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you have great success going into winter and through winter, and we'll see you at the next instructional video.